When we imagine people living in caves and hunting their own food, we see that as barbaric. When we imagine life without electricity or an indoor toilet, we think, how could you possibly live like that? And for some people today, just going 10 minutes without Wi-Fi and a latte is considered the realm of the savage. As society moves on and progresses, it brings us to new technological heights. It reduces our exposure to harmful things, and it offers more equality for previously repressed people. But as it does so, this progress illuminates the backwards nature of our former selves. So with that in mind, we're going to take a look at the possibilities of the future in a whole new light by considering the aspects of today's society that will be considered inhumane, immoral, or just plain stupid in the future. Prison. The current reoffending rate for prisoners in the United States is 60%. Even worse, it is responsible for a quarter of the world's prison population. These statistics make for pretty bad reading, but if America and a few other countries took a leaf out of Sweden's book, things might just change for the better. Whereas the US prison system is dangerously overcrowded, Sweden is currently in the process of closing down some of its facilities due to lack of use, as they only have 4,500 inmates out of a 9.5 million population, which is roughly one in every 2,000 people. Compare this to the USA, where one out of every 110 people is incarcerated, and you begin to see why something may not be quite right. The purpose of law should not be to create some crazy politician's idea of society, nor should it be to exact revenge. And, in a bizarre sense, it should not even compensate victims. The sole purpose of law should be to reduce crime. And if prison systems are doing the opposite of that, then something has to change. When our hospitals were making people sick due to the infections they caught, did we just carry on, cross our fingers, and hope for the best? No! We altered our working practices, policies, and procedures. So is the challenge now to reform our prisons, creating an environment more conducive to the rehabilitation of human beings. Unfortunately, the policy of most governments today is to throw criminals into a locked room with other bad guys and make them promise to be good once they come out. In Sweden, they treat their prisoners with respect, attempting to understand why that person did what they did, regardless if they were busted for smoking reefer or the most heinous of acts against humanity. They're all treated the same. And the result? Sweden has a 40% reoffending rate. So Sweden wins. The question is, will this lower crime long term? Will the future see all of humanity adopting this humane strategy? Will we begin to take a closer look at the psychology of criminals, their mental state, and other crucial factors such as race and poverty? Once you start treating humans like animals, they behave accordingly. But if prisons can change and become a place where people positively transform their lives, maybe, just maybe, we can be saved from another crappy reboot of Prison Break. And isn't that the real victory humanity needs right now? War. At some point in human history, war will be eradicated, either due to technology, a sufficiently enlightened and advanced society, or a race of space hippies who come along and put flowers in our plasma rifles. This utopian civilization is obviously not going to occur for millennia, but war as we know it, that's already an outdated concept. When we think of conflict today, we consider the brutal trench warfare of the First World War and the decades of conflict in Vietnam, Iraq, and Afghanistan. We think of millions of human boots on the ground, man-operated vehicles, and humans taking the lead in orchestrating missions designed to make tiny gains in land and infrastructure. But all of that is about to change, and we'll see such wars as archaic and foolish, because the next major conflict is likely to be extremely fast and extremely lethal. Albert Einstein predicted this with his famous quote, "I know not with what weapons World War III will be fought, but World War IV will be fought with sticks and stones." Now, the problem with this statement is that it simply hasn't come true and it likely won't. As Einstein imagined a future where weapons became more powerful and spectacular than anything we have today. Earth-destroying nukes are, of course, still a major threat to society. But because the launch of one certainly means the launch of hundreds, the prospect of mutually assured destruction has kind of put people off the idea of turning their foes into an irradiated puddle of goop. So rather than making weapons lethal out of sheer explosive power, we've made them deadlier by improving their efficiency at targeting individual threats. However, the worrying part is that we're now beginning to bypass humans at a certain point in the decision-making process, replacing them with machines. A recent quote by the U.S. Army's Major General William Hicks illustrates this perfectly, as he commented that the speed of events are likely to strain our human abilities. The speed at which machines can make decisions in the far future is likely to change our ability to cope, demanding a new relationship between man and machine. Right now, there are AI-programmed drones in the skies above the world's major theaters of warfare. And thankfully, these crafts still require a large level of human input in order to function correctly. But what happens when they don't? Will we look back at warfare today as old-fashioned, but in a good way? How will war change when you can send a squadron of hyper-fast lethal killing machines to wipe out your enemy's forces? Will we target drone operators or commanders rather than scores of infantry soldiers? Would we feel okay with a swarm of tiny nanobots reducing a whole army of humans to a fine pink mist? At what point will human combatants become obsolete? And how will we cope when our all-powerful killing machines make a mistake? Especially if it was a mistake the machines let happen. 13. Pooping. That war entry was pretty heavy. So, let's lighten the load a little by considering how humans might relieve themselves in the future. The act of dispensing our collective waste has taken several giant leaps over the course of mankind's history. As from our humble beginnings of pinching one off in the bush, humanity now enjoys the benefit of defecating in relative comfort, thanks to the invention of sewage systems and flushing toilets. Yet many people worldwide still don't have this option. Then there's the small matter of how to clean yourself up. Historically, we used sponges on sticks, wads of leaves and moss, and the Romans even had communal butt cloths to wipe themselves down while pooping in streams and rivers. Today, obviously, we're far too classy for that, using scrunched up recycled paper to sconch our mess away. But will future toilet historians see our use of the toilet as being as barbaric as the butt cloth? Maybe. So how will we do it? Hopefully it won't involve the three seashells from Demolition Man. That sounds kind of pinchy. We've had all sorts of devices pitched to us as the future of human toilet time, from vacuums and water jets through to toilets that stop your poop smelling bad. But the most likely end game for our dirty, dirty bottoms is that we may not need to poop at all. Or at least if we do, it won't be as messy. With the advancement of nutritional science, we may be able to develop food which has zero waste products. So in that instance, the only things you'll need to get rid of are the dead bacteria, mucus, fats, and salts your body excretes. And mopping this up might be as simple as blowing your nose. Have you ever seen a future sci-fi movie where folks are bare-butt sneezing in public? No! Because nobody except Strange Mysteries thinks of this stuff. You're welcome for that image. And if we can rid ourselves of this mucus excretion too, who knows? We might be able to use your now redundant cavity as some kind of special pocket. You wanna mug me for my smartphone? Go for it, pal. It's waiting for you right here between my sweet cheeks. 12. Torturing animals. Animals make us laugh, they make us cry, and they also make us full with their delicious, tasty flesh. If you've watched our recent video on 6 life-changing future developments, you'll know we discussed how synthetic meat may change our attitudes towards other living creatures. And when this happens, future society won't look back kindly on the way we treated our innocent animal allies. At the risk of inciting a memoir in the comment section, let's bring the subjects of 2 recent animal cruelty stories into the discussion. All praise be to Lord Cecil and King Harambe, 2 animals who were shot by humans for unconvincing reasons and whose deaths sparked an international outcry. But where is the outcry for the millions of baby chicks minced alive to make the colonel's produce? Why does nobody care for the cows, pigs, and sheep slaughtered mere months into their life, having spent their early years wallowing in their own filth? And does nobody care what happened to the pig who played baby? I hope he's okay. It's all well and good raising heck at the idea of a rich dentist popping a cap in the king of the jungle. Can you really do this with a straight face? If while you're complaining, you're also stuffing your mouth with 100 nuggets for 99 cents. As man begins to reduce its use of live animals for meat, we'll also see the same trend extend to scientific experimentation. Artificial human organs and flesh are well on their way, and once their production costs decrease, we'll have a far more accurate way of testing drugs and treatments. Once this happens, we'll perhaps start to value animal life, becoming a society more at one with nature. Maybe we'll allow creatures to roam amongst us. Maybe we'll give bonobos the vote. It's hard to say exactly what this world will look like, but it's not impossible that one day we'll consider the murder and torture of merely sentient beasts as equal to those same crimes being committed against those that are self-aware. And I, for one, cannot wait for a time when the police are forced to investigate cheeky monkey murders. 11. Education. It's fun when you know something your parents don't know, isn't it? Whether it's a neat fact about the world or how to program a Blu-ray player, we all feel that little bit superior when we get to teach the people who made us something new. But did you know that for centuries, human beings have been increasing in IQ until we stopped doing that just recently? The idea of one generation becoming smarter than the next has been observed and noted since the 1930s with something called the Flynn effect, which used IQ tests to measure the intelligence of a population over a period of time. Scores in these tests have risen consistently in developed nations since they began, leading many to believe that thanks to our increasing efforts in education, every generation has been getting smarter than their parents. Inevitably, if this continued, it would lead future generations being intellectually superior to us. But this might not actually be the case, as for some reason, humans are getting dumber. IQ scores in developed countries have either stalled or decreased slightly, and the reasons for this are not yet known. They could be indicative that the Flynn effect was flawed, with nutritional improvements or lack of disease affecting the results. Or alternatively, it could be that we've hit a natural barrier for improving human intelligence using our existing educational methods. James Flynn himself believes this to be the case, especially as our current educational systems seem to have a habit of teaching children to memorize answers to a test. Many have called for a reorganization of the school system, as they believe it has now outlived its usefulness. But whatever method we replace it with, hopefully we'll figure it out soon, before we get too stupid to remember what speaky word learn do. 10. Fossil fuels. Let's face it, folks, this one is so obvious and easy, we're only going to give it two script paragraphs. Our children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren will judge us to high HE double hockey sticks for all the random stuff we burn just to keep our butts warm. We've had viable alternatives to oil, gas, and coal for decades now. Yet we still persist in ruining the planet and fighting wars in order to continue our love-in with fossil fuels. Just let it go, folks. Fossil fuels don't love us back. They're so bad for us. All our friends said so, but we didn't listen. The sun loves us, though. It's always loved us. So isn't it time to take our giant ball of hot life-giving gas out of the friend zone? Nuclear power, solar energy, tiny hamsters in wheels. Literally anything would be better than the over-reliance we currently have on ancient dinosaur mush dug out of the ground. If we don't change things soon, we're going to seem as retrospectively dumb as those people in the 50s who smoked cigarettes thinking it was good for them. Or those girls who'd put mercury in their eyes to give them a sparkling shine. Is that what you want, folks? Do you want to look stupid in front of future people with their hover shorts and orgasm rays? I certainly don't. So let's get our asses in gear. Oh, speaking of asses. 9. Sex. Things could go either one of two ways here. Either we're going to get a whole lot freakier with a bunch of new gadgets enabling us to get down and dirty in new and depraved ways, or we'll turn into a race of complete germophobes afraid of touching each other. The first option is clearly the more tantalizing prospect, and it leads to a future where people will see our society as being as sexually repressed as those who came before us, if you'll pardon the pun. 100 years ago, those conservative old wimps were shocked at the sight of a woman's ankles during foreplay, but today, we enjoy all manner of insertion, extraction, and elaborate activities while we make love. But let's not pat ourselves on the back with a diamond-studded leather paddle, because there are many aspects of human sexuality which still remain firmly in the closet. Just think, masturbating was widely considered a sin until very recently in human history, and the female orgasm was only acknowledged in the 1960s, with some folks to this day still figuring out how to achieve one. However, due to the restrictions placed on people by the ideals of masculinity, femininity, and morality, there are some things many of us are unwilling to do to get our rocks off. But this is beginning to change. In 2014, the UK sex toy website Love Honey announced they'd sold 1 million sex toys over the previous 12 months, including vibrators, nipple clamps, and penile rings. If you connected all of the 120,000 penile rings they sold that year, you'd have enough to encircle the Empire State Building 20 times. The people inside might be annoyed, but you could definitely do it. Now, could you imagine people buying sex toys in this volume 50 years ago? Can you imagine your grandpa buying a sex toy? Don't do it, but can you? It wouldn't happen, because since then, society has become less anxious and more public about our sexual desires. As generations pass, taboos often fade into oblivion, and what we see as kinky and weird today could be entirely acceptable in the future. But there's also the chance things could move drastically in the opposite way, should a major event change our order of priorities. If a new sexually transmitted disease came out that turned your genitals into soup, or somehow alerted your mom every time you were having sex, then we'd suddenly have to redefine how much physical contact we deemed acceptable. Sex and relationship expert Dr. Laura Berman believes we'll go down this route and start using elaborate technology and neurological analysis to have better, but less intimate sex in the future. In this scenario, our current habit of touching each other physically in a sexual manner would be seen as the behavior of a barbarian, with a more clean, clinical approach taken to getting each other off. You know what? I always thought barbarians had a bad rep anyway, so I'm going to keep on as I am. Thank you very much, Dr. Lady. 8. Slavery. Oh hey, what's this entry doing in here? Didn't we outlaw slavery like a bazillion years ago? Well, America did, and so did many other countries around the world. But in fact, the number of enslaved people is estimated to be larger now than it ever has been at any point in human history. Sorry, Mr. Lincoln, just like John Wilkes Booth, you gave it a pretty good shot, but there's still work to do. There are approximately 30 million people living in modern slavery today, and this industry generates $32 billion for people traffickers every single year. Around 3/4 of these slaves are used for labor purposes, and the remaining quarter are enslaved for sex. 55% of all slaves are women and girls, and nearly half of the world's slave population can be found in India alone. Out of 162 countries ranked in order of its slave population, the US came in at 134th. That's not bad, but it's nowhere near the best, with an estimated 60,000 slaves still living in the United States today. The UK, Ireland, and Iceland jointly top the list of countries with the smallest slave population at 0.006% of their country's people, compared to the highest ranked 4% in Mauritania. But Britain's 0.006% still means more than 4,000 people are living in bondage inside the borders of the world's sixth largest economy. And that's the best percentage in the world. Admittedly, this translates to only 19 people in Iceland, but that's no consolation if you're one of those 19 people. Slavery is something we in the West thought had disappeared from the face of the earth a long time ago. But not only is it still present in most corners of the globe, it's also prevalent in our own backyards. History will judge slavery as one of the greatest sicknesses our planet has ever endured. And this is something we'll be dealing with for a long time yet. 7. Politics. Hands up if you feel Donald Trump represents your political views. Now hands up if you feel the same about Hillary. Well, from my high horse up here, I can see there are a whole lot of people not putting their hands up right now, And even if you threw Bernie Sanders, Gary Johnson, and the Zodiac Killer in there, we'd still have a fair few people with their arms stuck firmly beside them. The problem with most modern democracies is that for every person who is happy with their leader, there are many who are not. And those people don't get a chance to have their say until the next election comes along. In a two-party system, you'll always have huge numbers of people across the country who, for reasons of gerrymandering, political unpopularity, or sheer bad luck, don't get to decide on how their country is run. And this is equally true for countries with three or more parties vying for power. The only way for people to have more of a say in how their country is run is through effective mobilization and the dissemination of accurate information. And this is where big data and the internet are going to become very handy indeed. Whereas today the media takes the lead in hurling sensationalistic news at low information voters, technology brings with it ever more opportunity for individuals to communicate and persuade larger numbers of people. Another trend currently sweeping the globe is one of personalization. So why can't this apply to politics? If I believe in tough drug laws and my neighbor believes the opposite, is there a way we can both have what we want? Is there no way for a liberal and a conservative to have their own political choices applied to them and them alone? I don't know how this would work regarding immigration, mind you. Maybe those close the border folks would get a free blindfold or something. But if it made fewer people angry with the world, it's surely worth further discussion. A change in the way democracy is enacted and applied has been long overdue, and when it comes, we'll look back at our system today and laugh. That's if our faces haven't been burnt off from 2017's inevitable nuclear holocaust. 6. Medical care. Masochists aside, most people are pretty thankful that we live in an age where operations can be performed under the glorious haze of anesthesia, and that the local doctor isn't some quack who prescribes the same treatment for every illness. Flu? Let's drill a hole in your head. Back pain? Hole in the head? Giant hole in your head? You're a hypochondriac, get out of my office. We look back at the medical treatments of yesteryear with both amusement and fear. But you have to wonder which methods we use today will be seen as barbaric by our children and grandchildren. We inject vaccines into our bloodstreams. We amputate limbs with no prospect of regrowth. We slice skin off our butts and use it to fix our horrifically burnt faces. These are all vital and necessary treatments today. But will we mock them tomorrow? Perhaps mocked isn't the right word, but it's almost certain that generations to come will have access to a greater range of drugs and treatments than we do. And it's likely they'll be able to cure many of the illnesses we live in fear of. In our lifetimes, AIDS and cancer could be eradicated, as we've done with smallpox, and which we hope to achieve with polio in the next decade or so. But even if we can't cure these ailments, we may at least enjoy treatments which aren't as harsh on our bodies as those we use today. As anyone who's undergone chemotherapy will tell you, the side effects of anti-cancer drugs are far from pleasant. And hopefully, we may view these treatments as unnecessary, painful, and grotesque once we come up with a viable alternative. Gene editing tools may even make a cure for such diseases completely unnecessary, allowing humans to be born immune to devastating illnesses in the first place. But even if we're able to cure a multitude of diseases in the next few years, there's one area of human healthcare which we'll definitely look back on with derision, regardless of any technological breakthroughs. 5. Mental health. Retards, spastics, crazy people, psychos. These are just some of the pejorative terms we use to describe those with mental health conditions today. There's no doubt at all that these words will depart the realm of acceptability in the near future. But in the far future, when we understand more about the human mind, we may start to question why it took us so long to start taking mental health seriously. Depression is now the world's second biggest cause of disability. And even though we've witnessed the signs of this illness for most of human history, it's only recently we've started to develop effective medications which help to alleviate its symptoms, because it's only recently that we've started to actually care. Thankfully, we're beginning to improve on the existing medications and cognitive behavioral treatments offered now. But in the years to come, we also hope to develop an understanding of psychiatric disorders at a molecular level, gaining even greater insight into why certain conditions occur and what we can do to better treat them. Gradually, mental wellness will attain parity with physical health, and humans will be encouraged to take care of their mind as much as we do our physical bodies. We already know that isolation from human contact, weather changes, diet, physical exercise, and sleep patterns all affect your mental stability. But we don't do a great deal to alleviate these problems. We laugh at those who spend all day eating Doritos in front of the TV, but our ancestors might similarly mock us for how little we exercise our minds. If this kind of societal change does occur, we might start to be more empathetic of those who lash out or don't fit in because of their mental difficulties. Furthermore, we may also wonder if what we perceive as conditions or difficulties are something we should even cure at all. For example, there are many today who advocate for autism to be reclassified not as an illness, but as a distinct type of personality, one whose actions and reactions are entirely valid and not in need of treatment. It's an interesting idea, as although there are many obvious difficulties faced by autistic people, who is it to say what we should define as normal? Will it be seen as wrong to attempt to fix people with autism or other such issues? In the same way we see it as wrong to attempt to cure a gay person today. Many human behaviors have been derided as mental illness in the past. When black slaves ran away from their white masters, it was defined as drapetomania, and the act of masturbating was considered so serious a disease in Victorian times that it warranted the surgical removal of a woman's clitoris. That's irony. Victorian people all acting like they enjoy having a large stick up their ass. The definition of what constitutes a working human mind and a stable personality will almost certainly change once we understand more, and when it does, perhaps we'll be in a better position to judge who needs treatment and who does not. Few would argue that we shouldn't attempt to cure the minds of rapists, murderers, and people who like country music. But as for more complex issues, it's difficult to say who we'll deem it appropriate to treat in the future. However, what we can be certain of is that our current efforts in dealing with mental health will be considered brutal compared to the more insightful treatments that shall come to pass. 4. Inequality. Race, gender, sex. We humans sure do love to categorize, brutalize, and say mean things about people who are specifically different in meaningless ways. Nobody can argue that huge steps haven't been taken to help alleviate the effects of racism, sexism, and homophobia over the last century. But equally, it's hard to argue that this work is by any means finished. Black people still make up huge amounts of the prison population. Women still earn far less than men. And the idea that gay men dress well is just offensive. My friend Daniel is gay, and he looks like crap 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Picking apart several millennia of inequality is a pretty tough job, and it's going to take some time. But in addition to the various isms we know about, what others might make themselves known in our lifetime? Will there be a bigger fight against ageism, with a longer living, more active elderly population? Is it possible we'll even start to see stupid people as a repressed area of society? That may sound like a joke, but hear me out on this one. Intelligence and education are both affected by factors such as wealth, geography, your parents' influence, and your biological makeup, amongst other things. These are all the things a child cannot possibly influence. So, what will we do in the future to help those who had a bad start in life? Will we continue to mock them for things they could never hope to change? Or do we offer them a way out, an escape from ignorance, and a chance to make something better of themselves? Yes. It's funny when Kenny at the back of the class won't stop pushing crayons up his butt. But he's going to be the one on a crummy job later in life, he's going to be the one more likely to commit a crime, and he's going to be the one you're complaining about supporting on welfare when he loses his job for pushing even more crayons up his butt. Kenny is never going to stop doing the crayon thing. That's just how he likes to relax. But if he'd been given the chance to learn and play a bigger part of society even after he failed the first time, that's something we'd all benefit from. And this mantra applies to everyone, whether they've been disadvantaged because of their color of their skin, their gender, or who they like to bump uglies with. It all comes down to the same thing: giving people a chance to do what others take for granted. Society is slowly starting to allow more and more people to join in the party. And if future generations look down on us for our lack of inequality, I guess it's a good thing, as it'll mean progress will have been made. 3. Entertainment. Ever watch a TV show from your parents' childhood and wonder, how the heck did you guys get away with this? Well, that's what your kids will be thinking when you show them a rerun of Family Guy, The Simpsons, or even Modern Family. Because however woke we may believe we are today, the natural progression of society directs towards more understanding and fewer jokes at the expense of those who are different or marginalized. Shows from the early years of television are littered with homophobic and racist content, and people got away with it back then because they were considered of their time. But don't you ever wonder which shows, movies, and music we enjoy today, which will become offensive in the future? Have vegetarians been unfairly represented? Do ugly people save the day often enough? Are zombie flicks guilty of culturally appropriating the society of the undead? Of course, there's plenty of intolerance shown in modern programming which we know about already, without me having to make any up. In mainstream movies, you'll rarely see a black guy kissing a white girl. Fat people are constantly made fun of. And in action films, women are frequently used as a trophy to be acquired by heroic men. Don't get me wrong, I like trophies. They prove I'm good at stuff. But this isn't how real life works. And in the future, our entertainment will start to represent more of society more equally. And that means our media today will seem ignorant by comparison. Alternatively, it's possible we might actually become more tolerant of our past's intolerance, allowing it to stand as a lesson. And instead of laughing at jokes which mock those who are different, we laugh at those doing the mocking, as our outdated beliefs become amusing to those in the future. Or maybe we'll just have a boatload more reality shows where people eat kangaroo anuses for fun. Yep, that's more likely. 2. Working 9 till 5. Dolly Parton truly was a pioneer ahead of her time, as way back in 1980, she most famously exclaimed, "Working 9 till 5, what a way to make a living!" But how long will mankind continue to slave away at a desk, in a field, or in a voiceover booth for the benefit of strangers? Because let's face it, it's the rich folks who prosper the most from our existing system of employment and remuneration. Some humans work for pleasure, but most do so because we have to. However, when all of our doctors, truck drivers, and zookeepers are replaced by one single truck-driving, lion-taming, cold-curing robot, and humans become free of a repressive system of life-encumbering toil, folks might look back at society today and start to feel quite sorry for us. At Strange Mysteries, we've already spoken about the potential introduction of universal income, as with humans becoming less and less important, a guaranteed support system will eventually become a necessity, in whatever form it takes. But such a situation is considered to be decades ahead of us, if not a whole century. So how might work change before then? The answer is, drastically. Because the idea of a job is already changing within single generations, let alone between them. Take your parents, for example. They may have worked the same field their entire lives, and possibly even for the same company. But today, that simply isn't the case. Millennials spend, on average, 12 months in the same position, with this number expected to fall to 6 months in the next 5 years. We're also switching careers more than ever. So the idea of being a mechanic, veterinarian, or stripogram from the day you leave school until the day you retire is rapidly becoming outdated. The hours we work may also drop due to a number of factors. Because as more processes become automated, you'll need fewer humans to do things. So that means fewer work hours will be made available. 4-day working weeks are a distinct possibility within the next decade. And that's if you're not already enjoying such a situation, as more and more people switch to a freelance position. Freelance contractors often work fewer hours and days than most people, and they're able to command a higher fee for their hourly services because of the money they save companies, who no longer have to pay for the hours you waste taking a 30-minute bathroom break or a Candy Crush warm-up hour after lunch. Because of this, many people's permanent contracts are being replaced by freelance positions, as companies have found that temporary teams which come together on a single project, as you would for a production of a movie, are far more productive than those with a guaranteed position. The idea of hundreds of people chained to a desk in a giant company headquarters is already being ditched by more forward-thinking tech companies. But soon, any firm which values productivity is going to follow suit. And sure, everyday workers lose some job security in this situation, but you get to keep the same paycheck and you gain a whole bunch of spare time to boot. And speaking of spare time, at one, retirement. Here's life in a nutshell. You work hard until you're 60 or 65, then you go home for a nap, and you die. That's basically it. But will this change in our lifetime? Well, it already is, and in the future, we might consider our golden years in a whole different light. As the health of our elderly generation improves, thanks to advancements in medical science, people are not only living longer, they're also living more active lifestyles for longer. It is widely believed that the first human who will live to 150 has already been born. But aside from the trivial nature of record-breaking, it is also thought that the millennials are the world's first generation who are expected to live to 100 years old en masse. And with most of that being active and productive. 40 years, that's a long time spending playing chess in the park and telling kids to get off your lawn. The idea of retirement, therefore, needs to change. And will most likely start with the age at which it kicks in. The UK has already risen its retirement age, with both men and women scheduled for retirement aged 66, compared to 60 for women and 65 for men just a few years ago. This will increase as we reach the mid-21st century, and from the year 2067, Brits need to reach 73 before they can finish working. But is this actually a good thing? As manual labor jobs become obsolete, will we ever need or want to stop using our talents for financial gain? Sure, many of us might be tired of work and will use our 40 years of retirement to write a book or travel the globe, but equally, many may wish to continue working. There are millions of elderly people with vast swaths of useful experience and knowledge being ignored in favor of youthful, energetic minds. But in the future, we may see the idea of dismissing the contributions of the elderly as short-sighted and cruel. We have access to a huge database of information via the internet, yet we rarely tap into the equally useful knowledge stored in the minds of people who have seen the world, run industries, and enjoyed life. Today, society stops listening to people as soon as they accumulate weird crumbs around their mouths and start making mildly racist remarks over the dinner table. But half a century from now, as those beyond 60 become even healthier, we might take the opinions of our elders a bit more seriously. Because with their newly acquired energy, they'll be able to punch our lights out if we don't. So that's another one of our super long investigations. Did you like it? If so, tell us in the comments section, and we might make more. Also, what will you do with your 40 years of free time once you're a healthy, energetic old geezer? As long as it's clean, feel free to let us know that in the comments section too. But if it's dirty, just tell us in a private message.